Good morning, everybody, and thank you for joining us in person, and thank you for joining us online. For those who are online, we've been blocked in 248 countries on Facebook because of John Paul's amazing prelude. The algorithm thinks it's copyrighted and professional. It was done so well, so we hope you're tuning over to our YouTube channel today to be with us with those difficulties of domination algorithms, which fits into our theme today. So welcome, everybody who's here today.
I paid for it.
Yeah, John Paul paid for it, too. I'm sure it's how many, 100 years old now, or... It's 200 years old, too. So who, you know, this is part of what we face. So welcome. I hope all of you that are here today visiting or back after a trip and same online, we're glad with you. Thanks for joining us. As we gather each and every Sunday, we affirm each other, whoever we are and however we identify ourselves and whoever we love. This is a time to celebrate and claim our sacredness together. Also, we continue to be on this journey of truth and reconciliation, and we acknowledge the oral practice that we're on the traditional territories and the oral practices of the Blackfoot Nations, the Siksika, the Piikani, and the Kainai, and also the Foothills Métis District, and all people who make their home in southern Alberta as Treaty 7 people. A couple of announcements today. First of all, We'd love to invite all of you online or in person to stay connected with our weekly e-newsletter. You can use the QR code or email judy@mckillopunited.ca if you'd like to be a part of it. It's a great way to know what's happening both at McKillop, but also in a lot of events that we support as a community church. Also, thank you for all the ways you give. Money, as I say, is always energy. If you would like to give today, there's baskets at the back, or you can scan the QR code for all the donation options. Money allows us to be a faith community, a community of spiritually growing people that continues to care for ourselves, to reach out to our community, and to have amazing services like I hope today's is. There's a gentle yoga class coming up this week. I'm sure there's still space. It's $50 for six sessions or $10 drop-in. And then all the United Churches in Lethbridge are supporting a fundraiser to help the camp rebuild from the Kenan wildfire. There are tickets for sale after church. They're $50. You get a $25 tax receipt. It's going to be on Friday, April 26th at 6 p.m. There'll be a bake table, a quilt auction, camp merchandise for sale, dinner music, and all sorts of things. So I hope you can participate in that. And finally, for all those who are here in person today, we'd like to invite you to come upstairs afterwards to continue to be together, have a coffee, a treat, and grow in our time as a community. So let us enter this time with our opening song, All Praise to You, O God of All Creation.
Thank you.
Please be seated. Invite us into a moment of opening prayer, a time of gathering where we can feel more present in our bodies, identify what we might be grateful for, let go of what worries us. It'll be an opening prayer where there are moments of silence where you have your own space in your heart and mind and body to answer the prayer as you wish. So let us pray together. O divine of this amazing life that we have on this amazing planet, floating in the darkness of space, as we gather together on this day of beautiful weather, as we gather on this day, in this moment of silence, we let our hearts and minds speak the gratitude in our lives. And with the energy of gratitude, we pray, O Spirit of Life, that in this moment we gather, we may let go of what worries us, our burdens, our struggles, our confusion, our challenges. In this moment of silence, and as we let go of all that we carry, we pray that as we leave here today, we may pick it up and see it and touch it and hear different ways that we can work with what challenges us. O Spirit of Life, divine of this amazing planet, gather us in here today as we share stories, as we pray together, as we sing together, as we are community. May we see each other and this earth in different ways, and let love be our story. Amen.
Good morning. We're reading today a scripture reading, and the introduction to this reading is Jesus and the followers of Jesus lived in a time when they were dominated by the Roman Empire. Life was like a pyramid of hierarchy, some on top and some on the bottom. In some ways, the prevailing ambition that was spread was to climb the pyramid so you got more security and happiness and safety. Today, Jesus flips these thoughts. Jesus flips these thoughts upside down and suggests service and cooperation are the actual way. So, what do you hear from this passage? Reading from Luke 22, verses 24 to 27. A dispute also arose among the disciples as to which one of them was to be regarded as the greatest. But Jesus said to him, "The kings of the Gentiles lord it over them. Those in authority over them are called benefactors, but not so with you. Rather, the greatest among you must become like the youngest, and the leader like one who serves. For who is greater than the one who is at the table or the one who serves? Is it not the one at the table? But I am among you as one who serves." May the Holy Scripture bless our understanding and help us to live the truth we hear. Amen.
I'm gonna live so God can use me anytime, Lord, anywhere. I'm gonna live so God can use me anytime, Lord, anywhere, Lord, anytime, Lord, anywhere. I'm gonna live.
Our story today is a First Nations story, and it's called Walking Together. It's written by Elder Albert D. Marshall and Louise Zimanyi, and it's a story, Walking Together. Let's find out what it means to walk together. When we walk together in a good way, we learn to see the world through two eyes. We receive the gifts of Mother Earth through stories. When we walk together in a good way, things are revealed. We hear those who are returning and those who stayed, sing the lands of water awake after a deep rest. When we walk together in a good way on Turtle Island, we learn we are all connected. We are never alone. We need each other. Miwaka, together we are strong. When we walk together in a good way, we learn about the gifts and stories of our family, of the lands and of the waters, those who are here before us and those who be here after us. When we walk together in a good way, we learn the languages of the land. When we walk together in a good way, we give back gifts by taking care of our family. We leave things as they are. We take only if there is enough. We ask before we take. We listen for the answer. We share. We sing the Mother Earth song. We say thank you, Willan, Miigwech. When we walk together in a good way, we go to what we love. We go to what we need. Water, stick, rock, frog. When we walk together in a good way, frog is one of our teachers. We wait, listen, watch for frog near the ponds. We breathe in the stillness. When we walk together in a good way, things are revealed. We hear frog croaking. We see frog. Frog watches us. We speak frog. When we walk together in a good way, we listen to a story about frog. They live in muddy waters and has wrinkled skin. They did not share the gift of flowing water with people and the animals. Ruby-throated hummingbird, wild daisies, flowing river, and sunning turtles are our teachers too. When we walk together in a good way, we share wonder as we wander and play. Watching stories, we weave and tell new stories in a circle under the willow. The stories of water and lands and the teaching of the flyers, the crawlers, and the swimmers and the four-leggeds grow inside us. Like flossy milkweed seeds, they're carried on the wings for future generations. When we walk together in a good way, we remember together we are strong. When we take care of the land and water and the land and water take care of us, just like the braided sweet grass, we are stronger together. When we walk together in a good way, we learn to know the world through two eyes. Walking Together, Elder Albert D. Marshall and Louise Zimanyi.
Please stand and join us.
We cannot
be seated. Well, we are continuing our series, The Stories We Live By. And today we're exploring us over them, the story of domination. And for me, this one might be the hardest of them all. It might be the hardest of them all because I'm embedded in it in ways that I can't understand yet. It might be the hardest of all because I think many of us, and maybe yourself included, it feels overwhelming. We don't know what to do with it. And so we just don't want to talk about it. You know, just a little bit of content warning. It's like we're going to explore it, and there's going to be some things brought up. So just be gentle with yourself. As we talk about this, it's not about feeling guilt or shame, because we have to remember stories are so powerful. The stories we live by influence our brain. The stories we live by influence how we think about ourselves and how we live in the world and how we find meaning. And so if we never explore the stories, and these stories have been thousands of years, I mean thousands, this story of domination has been thousands and thousands and thousands of years. If we never explore it, how do we expect to ever find a different story that might be more life-giving, that might be more healing? And so I want to acknowledge as we head into this first one that really comes from the work of Brian McLaren and Garth Higgins. Brian's part of the Center for Action and Contemplation, and Garth Higgins lives with a great Irish accent in Northern Ireland and went through what it's like to be dominated in the Civil War. And so remember, these stories that we're exploring are all solutions to how do we find peace and security and happiness. So this story of domination is one way that humans have come up with as one way that we find peace and security and happiness. And it's the story of us over them. And so for me, the domination story really has three layers that I want to explore with you. And we're going to explore them through short videos that helps unpack them with, I think, images and hearing different things. What is the domination story? What is it? Do you have any clue? Well, here, first, the story of the domination is a story of thousands and thousands of years of finding peace and security through violence and war. And it ripples through all the empires that all us species have lived in.
You are beaten. It is useless to resist. Don't let yourself be destroyed as Obi-Wan did. There is no escape. Don't make me destroy you.
Hier tragen und wir werden in unserem Zeichen dienen. vegan!
My fellow citizens, at this hour, American and coalition forces are in the early stages of military operations to disarm Iraq, to free its people, and to defend the world from grave danger.
Мною принято решение о проведении специальной военной операции. Ее цель – защита людей, которые на протяжении 8 лет подвергаются издевательствам, геноциду со стороны киевского режима.
Discover your power. Join me, and I will complete your training. With our combined strength, we can end this destructive conflict and bring order to the galaxy.
I'll never join you!
If you only knew the power of the dark side.
If you only knew the power of violence and domination.
This is one of the stories that affects our world. I mean, just think, you know, the Liberal government's trying to get to 2% of GDP for military spending in Canada. You know, the pictures up there, the black and white of the thing were released by the Israeli Defense Force and voices of America pinpointing precision bombing of Gaza. It's, you know, this is one of the stories we live in. This is domination. This is a story that Jesus was struggling with too, with the Roman Empire. It's nothing new. It's part of our history. Well, it leads to the next story. You know, the story of domination is just not bombs and nuclear weapons and conflicts. The story pervades and comes deeper into our own personal lives. The story of domination between us on an interpersonal, a cultural, and a political level.
My military, that's what you have insulted.
Forgive me, Father, I meant no disrespect.
Don't do this. He's your son.
We'll see. Rise and fight, Prince Zuko, so you can learn some respect.
It's going to be a bloodbath for the whole. That's going to be the least of it.
One of these days. Pow! Right in the kisser. Bang! Soon. I'm going to the moon!
Sound of his own voice and his own attacks, but he doesn't actually check the facts.
So the high school drama teacher over here accuses others of liking the sounds of their own voices. This from a guy who, if he were made of chocolate, he would eat himself.
where we have some of the dumbest leaders in the world. We have losers. We have losers.
They're losers. They're just losers.
We have very stupid people.
We have stupid leadership. How stupid are our leaders? How stupid are these politicians to allow this to happen? How stupid are they?
That is, was a, honestly, a...
Oh!
Compassion is a sign of weakness.
Compassion is a sign of weakness. Do you see how culturally, politically, in our families, in our own lives, like, I've been a dominator, I've been dominated, maybe you've been dominated, maybe you've been a dominator, that we glorify violence, that we glorify winners and looters, that our culture is just part of this for centuries and centuries and centuries. So it leads to the final story. You might be saying, thank God, can John Paul please play something great after this? But the final story is our domination over nature.
Milhouse, you don't care about the environment.
Hey, I am very passionate about the planet.
Say global warming is a myth.
It's a myth. Further study is needed.
That's for selling out your beliefs.
The evidence is everywhere. Burning forests in Argentina, massive floods in Bangladesh, drought in Spain. The impacts of climate change are here and they're getting worse. And according to a landmark United Nations report, not only are some of these impacts worse than previously known, some may already be irreversible. Noted that each additional fraction of warming had serious implications for life on Earth. The report laid out 127 of these threats, including the growing loss of usable farmland and increasing drought, which will threaten the global food supply,
rising sea levels and floods, which are already driving tens of thousands of people from their homes, growing numbers of punishing deadly heat waves, and increasing extinction of plant and animal species.
How are you feeling? You know, I was apprehensive talking about this today. Because really, when we look at culturally, you know, we don't want to talk about it. I feel overwhelmed by it. I feel saddened by it. I feel trapped by it. I pray that somehow we'll get out of this storyline that's hurling us to some future like Wall-E, where the humans have to leave space, the planet Earth, because there's nothing left here. You know, Gareth Higgins says about this, the story of domination is so deeply rooted in our world, it takes me a lifetime, and I'm still figuring out how my life can be entangled and disentangled from the stories of domination. And I feel the same way. You know, it's such a part of who we are. It's one of the dominant stories that is part of our species. And Jesus was working with it. Even heard how the disciples were working with it. The disciples, they grew up in the domination society of the Roman Empire that was dominating the Jewish people. They wanted to be on top. They wanted to have the dominant power so that they could find security and happiness and peace. And so what do we do? What do we do? Do we join the story of domination? Do we run from it and, you know, go towards our addicted behaviors or accumulation or isolation? Or do we find an antidote, a way between the story? Remember the seventh story. The seventh story is, here it is, us and us and us and more of us and some of us for more of us. And the seventh story is also, as in this next slide, it is human beings are not the protagonists. You see, the dominating story says that we are it. But in the seventh story, love is the protagonist. And you know what? I think Sting, in this song that someone sent to me after listening to last week's sermon, really speaks to what the seventh story is. Love is the seventh wave.
All the nations, everything that falls away, I see. There is a deep
Go Sting. Let's all get up and reggae around the room. There's a deeper world than this, don't you understand, tugging at your hand? There's a deeper wave than this, won't you listen to me? I say love is the seventh way. I mean, isn't this what Jesus was trying to say? Isn't this the good news of Jesus? That there is another way, a way between. What does it mean? What are three practical things we can try in this overwhelming word to do? Well, first, it's a community of service. This is our greatest opportunity as a faith community we have right now than anything in the world. We can come and play at church. We can come and play at being church, of being happy, of saying everything's great, ignoring everything going on in the world, and living, you know, a dominating religion. Or we can be a community of service. That's what Jesus was saying. Coming to churches isn't about being the best place at the table, getting your fire insurance. It's, you know, about looking good. It's about finding this seventh way of love, being encouraged to live it, and then flipping everything upside down so that we are servant leaders. That we care more than our individual stories, and we care about love. Love for the least, the love for those who have been dominated by our dominating society. Jesus was saying that over and over and over. What would that mean for us as a church, as McKillop? That our life is about love for the least, the dispossessed, the disposed, the crushed, and not about a theology of prosperity and a theology of status quo and a theology of us against them like our world is. The second practical way, if we want to get there, comes from our First Nation siblings, our brothers and sisters, seeing with two eyes. What did you think of that in the story? I think Jesus is also trying to ask us to see with two eyes. How do we see with two eyes? Well, two eyes, the story says, when we walk together in good ways, this is the first step, when we walk together for good ways. So it's just not about our story for happiness, security, and peace. We go to what we love. We go to what we need. And we hear the stories of others. Do you see how in the book with the two eyes is the stories of the frog, the stories of the trees? What would happen if we saw with the two eyes of love, which takes us to other stories than our own? You know, I'm always wrapped up in my own story. I don't know about you. And we're wrapped up in our own stories of our communities, our countries, our religions, our tribes. But what happens if we went to the dispossessed, the disposed, the dominated, and listen to their stories? What would the story of the tree say to us of how to see with two eyes and what does it mean to find the way between of love? What would the story of the rivers, of the watershed of the Old Man River flowing to the Hudson Bay, what would their story teach us? What would these stories tell us? It would require us to listen. And finally, as you've already heard, is serving the least. This is what is the antidote to the domination story, is serving the least. And for me, the least in our world is so great, it's overwhelming. But for me, I think the least, as we're coming to see it, is the earth. The earth has no voice. Do the trees get up and go around and make guns and shoot us when we go deforest the forest? Do the salmon who are going extinct jump out of the water and put up signs and do nonviolent resistance saying, "Don't eat us, we're dying"? Do the caribou in the north that are being affected by oil sands go and bomb the pipelines? See, we've been so wrapped up, and I have too, so this is not about feeling guilty, this is not about us feeling shamed. It's about when we see the stories as they are, we have a moment where we can work in small ways towards liberation for us and us and us and more of us. Because really, when you think about it, when you've dominated somebody, I don't know, we do it. We're trained to do it. Even in sports, you know, look at, I really think curling is a nonviolent sport now compared to the rest of them. You look at our sports, which are so violent, you win something by dominating. How long do you feel good? How long does that savor that I got what I want in a personal relationship, in an organization you're part of, at your job, with the earth? How long does that feel good for? You win a video game. You win something online. How long does that feel good? How long does it last until you have to do it over? You see, these things, this way between is finding us a way where we find true happiness and love. It's a call that Gareth Higgins says best here, that the antidote to this story is we're not masters of our own domain, but it's waking up that we're partners in the evolution of goodness. We're invited to be immersed in the hopeful practice towards the common good. We're invited to connection, not separation. For listen to me, girl, there's a deeper wave than this. And I say, love is the seventh wave.
Thank you.
Please be seated. Come to a time of prayer to hold in our hearts the healing of our lives and the world. We'll have a moment of spoken prayer, a moment of silence prayer. If you wish, you can join in the prayer that Jesus taught his disciples. And afterwards, our music groups are going to sing a song, which comes from the South African tradition of a song, which is called Come Walk With Us. Come walk with us, the journey is long. Come walk with us, the journey is long. The journey is long. The journey, the journey, the journey is long. The journey, the journey, the journey is long. We're going to be learning this song as a congregation over these next few weeks, and you'll sing it next week, but it is a song that in community we are called to walk this story of love together. And even though it's long, we are together. So let us pray. Spirit of love and life, O divine of many names and yet none at all, we acknowledge today that sometimes our hearts are stretched thin. We have our personal challenges. We see the challenges of the world. We hear and see the devaluing of nature, of people of color, of those of differing abilities, of women, of migrants, of trans, of gays and lesbians. And this list, O Spirit of Life, is incomplete. It sometimes feels so exhausting. And yet we hold fast because we affirm, we carry hope in our hearts. Hope that together we can dismantle systems of domination. Hope that flows through your presence in our hearts and lives, that whispers to us through nature and others that we can look for another way. We pray today that however thin our resilience may be wearing, that we do not give up or give in. We pray that we look around and see in our community here, in person, online, the spirit of love, that we can do more together in the story of love than we can do separately. We pray that you help us grow in what it means to be servants to ourselves, to each other, to the suffering of our world and to the earth. Because we feel in our hearts we must not give up. We join, O gracious God, and thousands of unseen people around the world as we all move for justice, as we live for peace. We pray that you'll not let us rest until we're heard, that we'll not rest until equity is made real. We pray that you lift us beyond both fear and conformity, beyond numbing and running away from the need to feel superior to others or feeling the inadequacy alike. Enable us, O Christ, to walk together as equals, at home in the great web of life. And so in this moment of silence, we hold our prayers for ourselves, for each other, for healing, for courage, for freedom, for all the things that we hold dear. Spirit of love, help us to look within our own hearts and to find burning love at the very center of who we are, no matter what we've done or haven't done, how others have treated us or not treated us, the things we have to do or forgotten. But in the very center of our community and hearts, may we find hope for the world lives, faith in our humanity, that we'll find the strength and courage as a community to walk on the journey towards love, and that you will come and walk with us. As we join together in the prayer that Jesus taught his disciples, our breathing life, who art in everything, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Join in the walk. May we join in the song as we leave here from day. And as we leave, everybody's invited to come upstairs for a time of coffee and fellowship. There's also tickets for sale for the Canyon Church Camp if you're interested in that. And we hope everybody at home, you have a wonderful afternoon. I've missed one of my papers here. Here we are. I'm not always organized. May we, you know what, as we go from here, may we hear once again this blessing from Sting. At the still point of destruction, at the center of fury, all the angels, all the devils, all around you, can't you see? There's a deeper wave than this rising in the land. There's a deeper wave than this. Nothing will withstand. I say love is the seventh wave. Amen.
Please join us in singing.
Let us sing this song for the turning of the world, that we may turn as one. With every voice, with every song, we will move this world along, and our lives will
do.